March 9th, 2015, CPDC. So first up on the agenda, are you guys here for 30 Haven Street? No? Oh, you are. Okay, good. Then we'll go straight to you. Perfect. Let's start with 30 Haven Street, request for minor modification to site plan review.
So we're just requesting a modification to the 2010 original site plan approval to remove the concrete requirement in the...
Okay.
We just feel that it's unnecessary, that there's been no issues since opening, and it's only going to cause more maintenance for the city.
So this was there, this was put there originally to prevent cars from
just crossing over the center line.
Parking into two spots, mm-hmm. Yeah. Potentially.
Yes. Originally it was supposed to be an island, but there was no space for it, and then it was modified to become the stamped concrete, but we don't feel that there's any need for it.
Okay. So I was looking in our packets, and there was a reference to the CPDC denying this change back in 2012.
There's a little bit of history with this particular item. It was originally stamped concrete, as she had mentioned. They came back and requested that be changed to like a stamped asphalt center area. And then at one point, the town engineer on behalf of Oak Tree, who had been working to clear up some last issues with the site, said that they would be interested in having that even reduced from just the stamped asphalt to nothing at all. And at that point, the CPDC said, nah, just keep it the way it is with the stamped asphalt.
Okay. Hmm. And at that point, the building wasn't open yet, right? So now we've got...
It wasn't fully populated, yeah.
And now we've got full population in the use of that lot.
Yeah.
So a good kind of sample size.
I did speak with the town engineer and the police chief, both of who think that it's not going to be a safety issue if it's removed. From their standpoint, you know, if the CPDC wanted to waive that requirement, they'd be fine with it. They have no issues with it.
Okay.
Any concerns?
No, I don't.
I mean, it would have been nice if we had the extra room, but we don't, so.
Right. John, you're just coming in the middle. We're talking about...
It's left over. When it was the planter, it made more sense.
Right.
I'm sorry, what was that?
When it was a full planter, it made more sense all the way across, but it doesn't make any sense as a stamp. You can't see it now, can you?
Right.
Yeah, you're right.
Stamped concrete.
Yeah. Oh, true. All right. Well, any concerns from your perspective?
I'm not sure our perspective matters, but since we already discussed this, it didn't seem to get done. I mean, you're right. The stamped concrete by itself doesn't mean all that much. But it's this change and just never got done.
Right.
Nor did we get what, you know, like you said, the original intent was to have a whole planter in there and to soften the parking lot. And that, nothing got done with that, so.
Yeah, I don't think there's any room for it. Or at least I said there's no room for it. And the aisles are 24 feet right now to the edge of the parking stripe. It's just unclear whether that stamped asphalt is within the 20 feet of the parking space.
It looks like it is.
Yeah, I think it would.
Yeah.
So there's no room for a continuous planter, which was the original intent for the trees and all of that. That all went away.
Mm-hmm. All right.
Okay.
Do we have a motion?
Move that the CPDC determined that the change required 30 Haven Street parking lot is a minor modification.
Do we have a second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Move that the CPDC approve the minor modification for the site plan Oak Tree Development, 30 Haven Street, in the Brandy Court parking lot.
Second.
All those in favor?
You're done.
Thank you.
Who seconded?
I'll make
Nick.
I'm gonna second everything tonight.
All right, so next on the agenda, public hearing for the outdoor storage special permit at 50 Walker's Brook Drive, Walpole Outdoor LLC. So assume you guys are here for that.
Yes.
Okay, great. So Gina and Jesse, anything you wanna do to introduce this?
We do have a public hearing notice.
Oh yeah, I'm sorry.
Does need to be read.
Sorry guys.
A little rusty.
Yeah.
Notice is hereby given under section 4.3.3 and section 4.3.2.9 of the Reading Zoning Bylaw. Community Planning and Development Commission, CPDC, will hold a public hearing on Monday, March 9th, 2015 at 7:45. Can we start?
Actually, I have 7:37. 7:40.
7:40. All right. We gotta wait a few minutes.
Sorry.
Rusty. We are very rusty. We haven't met in 2 months.
I'll take up reading it from where I left.
It's been a long winter.
Yeah.
Let's see. Did we want to make you talk about her sign?
Sure. So we're going to jump to the 50 Walker's Brook Drive preliminary review of proposed sign changes. Okay. And that's this document?
Right. And there's some drawings in your desk packet as well. They are in black and white, but Gene has them in color on the screen.
This is the existing conditions for the freestanding sign.
Okay.
Just add a whole little snow up there. And
yeah.
Yeah, existing.
Here's the wall signs. Existing. And then just to put together a nice comparison.
I didn't, actually.
Oh, the applicant put together a nice comparison. Thank you.
Yes. Which this one is.
Just channeled it.
Yeah.
What's changing? So, basically, there's a little bit of a color change, a little bit of an illumination change. So they're going with a blue panel to a black. They're going with neon to LED. They're going with a little bit of a different use on the lower sign in terms of the material. The cabinet stays the same. The freestanding goes from 5 tenant logos to 6 tenant logos. Bose has left and is off the sign, so that'll be replaced by Sunbrella, correct?
No, Sunbrella is replacing the sponsorship on the top.
On the top, okay.
Matt, Happy Busher, Julie's Furniture Center.
Okay.
We added the beanstalk is changing from Beantown to Beanstalk. And we've added Walpole
right
to the sign. Mm-hmm. And Paul's TV is current, and Fuddruck is current. This is for the pylon sign. So we're adding, putting Walpole, giving them a presence down in that pylon.
Okay.
Is the added tenant.
So to see what that looks like. Again, it's the black background, and then it's just one more tenant in this block.
Mm-hmm.
We had to restructure that whole block because of the all the graphics and them trying to make it all fit correctly and
right.
Look readable. The way we have it now, it's all stacked in individual names. We're unable to do that with these graphics because they would stretch out too far and not look readable. So we had to go with the side-by-side option, and that's why we're showing this. The Jordans on the top is channel letters. The Jordans is channel letters now, and we're replacing it with new channel letters.
Right.
To make an improvement on two things. One is we're rebranding Jordans in general, and our font has changed slightly of the Jordans. The R got a little less swing to it. The J got a little more swing to it. So you'll see in the packages that actually reduced the square footage of the top sign because of the font change, okay? We're going with the magenta, the Jordans magenta up top. And the furniture below right now is not channel letters. The existing condition is blue face that's illuminated from fluorescent lighting in the back. So we're trying to standardize that whole top to channel letter.
So that's interior illuminated, right?
And that's illuminated within the letters with LED. Everything is being proposed to go LED to eliminate the existing neon, which is phasing out in the industry, along with fluorescence to help us with maintenance and reduce our consumption, electrical consumption is our hope. So that's the top, the Jordan's part. And it's a black metal background. Right now it's existing, it's a blue metal background. We're trying to shift from the blue to the black. And the bottom panel is a flex face, which is opaque. Everything's opaque other than the graphics and the letters, which we'll get a sample of that to you guys as well so that you can see it. It's triple printed black, so it's for superior opaqueness. Probably the wrong word, I apologize, but
opacity.
Yeah, we've discussed that in length as well. And the LED is going behind that flex face as well. So the whole sign becomes LED. And we did a lumen calculation that we presented. I apologize, the first one was incorrect. And I had to go through with our sign company. We revised it today, and that's what that revised summary is. That has more accurate photometric illumination values to compare the existing fluorescent lamps to the new LED. We definitely wanted to display that it's not our intent to make things superior and brighter. We're just trying to change over to a more reliable product for less energy consumption and less maintenance is our hope. We've had great success at other locations with it. The overall footprint of the sign is not changing. Square footage of the perimeter is not changing, and the actual graphics square footage is reducing slightly once again because of having to just reformat to make everything more readable.
Is the black background part of your rebranding?
At this location it is, and we did it up at our Nashua location as well, yes. So I anticipate it will continue on at the other locations as we get to them with different projects and things like that, we would phase it in.
And then how do you determine the placement of each of these businesses on the sign? Is it driven by their footprint in the store, things like that, or is it just really kind of
fitting
what works best?
Yeah, I think it really comes down to Elliot. He gets very involved with this and looks at this stuff. But I don't think there's a real rhyme or reason as far as seniority goes or anything like that with the tenants. They're pretty well balanced. The IMAX Theater is critical as far as the sponsorship goes, so that kind of stands out like Jordan's, but everyone else is, I think, pretty well balanced just to get the symmetry correct on the sign.
Is that a single panel, the large piece below?
That is correct.
So when you change the sponsorship,
we have to change
the
whole sheet.
Thing?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. We talked about that in length as well. If you look at our existing condition right now, coming up the hill and down at the pylon, we've had a few versions of changes of both the sponsorship and tenant changes, which is part of this as well. We've had those moved out, yada-da. So with that, when we try to just do one panel, it stands out because the rest is so faded that as a company, we've pretty much made the decision, Elliot specifically saying, look, that doesn't represent us well or anyone else. You know, this piece, we unfortunately, it's a cost of business. We've got to keep looking right and do the whole face. So that kind of brought it all to one face, and well, we went back and forth for months on that one. But it doesn't seem very logical financially, but it's the best aesthetics for everybody. It's not me looking at this mismatched sign.
It's good to hear that the discussion was had, oh, yeah, and that the decision was made.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Instead of, you know, coming around and like,
up,
yeah,
yeah,
chopping
yeah,
up
right,
and trying
yeah
to like
go out there with your razor blade.
Yeah, yeah.
It almost looks like that. It's some of
yeah
coming up the hill. I mean, that face is really cracked, tough shape.
Mm-hmm. That looks nice.
Two comments, or one question, one comment. Is Paul's TV, is their logo or whatever that is, really that simple?
Yeah, it is actually. Right now it's black and red, but we're getting away from that because the black background, the red really, Ellie didn't like the red, stood out too much. So, yeah, and they've actually changed their font slightly and made it even simpler with that version. So, yes, it is. It's very plain, very
okay
simple. Same up in Nashua as well. That's them rebranding themselves too.
Yeah.
Right.
And the only other thing I would say is that when I first looked at this, it almost looked like Sunbrella was sponsoring IMAX. They look like they're tied together, and I don't have a suggestion on.
They are.
They are.
It is the Sunbrella IMAX Theater.
There you, okay, then.
and that was another month it took to squeeze those two together.
Right.
Actually, I think when we got the approval for the Sunbrella sponsorship, you guys had mentioned that too.
Right.
And Elliot did, and we had to, on the highway side, we actually lowered it and represented that a little closer.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah.
You guys were right on the
I
same
forgot
page
about that,
them,
yeah.
Because it needed to be, not look separated, but it's the Sunbrella IMAX Theater.
Yeah, because it was, who was it before Tempur-Pedic?
It was Comcast.
Comcast. Yeah. Comcast, then Tempur-Pedic, then Sunbrella.
Verizon. It was Comcast,
Verizon,
then it was Verizon. Then it was Tempur-Pedic.
Okay.
Now it's Sunbrella, and hopefully it's going to stay Sunbrella for at least a, it's been difficult just getting across the finish line. Hopefully they'll stay a longer term than the others did. You know, it'd
yeah
be nice to settle down.
It's a wonderful
6 or 7 years.
Yeah,
yeah, that's nice. So we're not approving anything tonight, right? Is this a preliminary review, or are we actually approving this?
Well, we wanted to show the board because it was the only thing that when Jesse and I looked at it, we said, you know, it probably could be approved administratively, but
yeah,
where the illumination was changing, you know, I think the way it was decision was drafted the last time, it was if you're just swapping out a panel, certainly staff can do that. This is a little bit of rebranding. It's a little bit of new lighting. It's a little
mm-hmm
bit of a little bit more than just swapping out a panel. So we thought we'd at least get your feedback. If everybody was okay with it, you know, we could do it administratively. But
yeah,
where this is so visible, we didn't want to make that leap.
Is there one of these for the wall sign as well?
Yes.
That's the top panel. I think he broke this down into two different. I think I can explain everything for you if you.
Bottom half of the sign.
Okay, but that's not, that's,
that's
not
the overall.
Yeah, okay,
yeah,
there it is.
So this sign, the top, again, at Jordan's and Furniture are both channel letters currently, just the existing font, and is a magenta and blue for Furniture. So we're going all magenta with the Jordan's and the Furniture channel letters again. And that background is a blue metal panel, flat, that we're changing out to a new black metal panel, as well as putting the new Sunbrella over the IMAX 3D theater, and it's crunched together to look that way. So the top is just redoing what's existing with new faces, new letters, spruce it up, LED lighting as well, get rid of the neon that's up there, okay? The bottom panel is two panels, because it's so big they can't make it one big section, so it's two. And that's the same process as down on the pylon sign. We're going to strip out the fluorescent, retrofit it to LED, and install the two new faces on the existing cabinet. The existing cabinet is blue, so we'll be coming back and painting the sides of it black so it matches the faces. Same as down at the pylon. All the same process, same products, same comparisons on lumens that we've presented. Mm-hmm. They're very close. I was expecting, originally, the first draft we did, it showed that the fluorescent lumens were so much more than the LED. And I knew that wasn't correct, so we had redone them and looked at a different calculation to compare the two. And with that, they've come much closer together. But the LED still is slightly lower in lumen output than the fluorescent. So we're expecting to have very similar results as a brand new sign would be when we put it up.
Right.
And we changed Beantown to Beanstalk. Walpole is on that sign now. Paul's is on that sign. Richardson's is on that sign. Fuddruckers. So the only thing really new to that is just the new graphics for everybody, the background color and the sunbrella, mm-hmm. and the LED changeover. Same square footage on the outer perimeter, less square footage on the graphics. On the Jordans, it got slightly smaller. Again, not by intent, but by design. We've already completed the other sunbrella signs that you guys had approved back in 2014. Yeah. They're all up and operable. So this is just to close the door on both. This got dragged out more complicated because it wasn't just revolving around the sunbrella, but it was also revolving around the tenant changes, the move out of Bose, the Adventures Road course coming in, Jordan's rebranding, and the condition of the existing signs. Just the floor.
We appreciate how fast you take action on these things after you get approved. We've got a number of things in town that have been hanging out there for a while.
And trust
this
me,
is refreshing.
This has been a thorn in the side. I wish it was done right now, but understanding the scope and the change of it.
We
were under the impression we would just do the sunbrella, but then things got all bobbled up, and you know, talking to Gene and Jesse, it was pretty obvious that the changes required a little more review than the standard.
Good.
So whatever you want to do, you want us to do it administratively, or if you want to take the vote since we're all here, that works too.
Did you want to include any conditions? At all.
I don't think we particularly need to. Yeah.
Think of off the top of my head.
Yeah. Move that the CPDC approve the Jordan's Furniture sign alterations for administrative approval by staff.
Second. All those in favor?
So if you got some last minute things that need, then they can take care of it.
Yep.
Hopefully not. I think we're good to go. Thank you. We really appreciate you guys looking at this.
Yeah, sure.
Great.
Oh, this looks good. Okay. Now we can move to the public hearing. Sorry about that earlier.
Can I start from where I left off?
Take it from the top.
Notice is hereby given under section 4.3.3 and section 4.3.2.9 of the Reading Zoning Bylaw. The Community Planning and Development Commission will hold a public hearing on Monday, March 9, 2015 at 7:45 p.m. in the Selectmen's Meeting Room at Reading Town Hall, 16 Lowell Street, to hear the application from Walpole Outdoor LLC for the property located at 50 Walkersbrook Drive, Assessor's Map 18, Lot 3. The applicant is seeking a special permit for outdoor storage for the display of sheds at Jordan's Furniture in accordance with section 4.3.2.9 of the zoning bylaw. A copy of the application and associated plans are available to the public in the Community Services Department in Town Hall Monday through Thursday from 7:30 a.m. to 5:30 p.m. and Tuesdays from 7:30 a.m. to 7 p.m.
Great, thanks. So this is how we normally handle public hearings. We'll ask staff to kind of open it up, introduce it. We'll turn it over to you guys, and you can provide your overview of the project. We'll discuss it, have any questions addressed to you. If anyone from the public shows up, we'll give them an opportunity to speak, and then we'll close out the public hearing, review the material, and likely approve it. So, Gene, Jesse, any?
We went out there and took a look at it the other day. So this is kind of hard to describe, but it's through the main showroom, there's this little outdoor area, and what they're calling for is, this is a doorway that takes you out. I guess they're currently using it just as an outdoor seating area for employees to eat their lunch. And so they want to put in three sheds, the classic Cape style, the signature, and the salt box, and those would remain out there as structures and would be taken down for the winter. And so that guests can go out there and actually see the sheds that Walpole sells and be able to look at them up close. And the building inspector joined us, fire chief joined us, they had no concerns, no comments. So that's basically what the staff has taken on so far.
Great, thank you.
Sid Tillsley, I'm the vice president of Walpole Outdoors. We started to have a store with Jordan's probably 2 years ago in April. And when we did that, part of the discussion was, geez, if you want to use the outdoor, you know, part of it, we will put that in the lease. We said, fine. So we had enough to do just to open the store, okay? But part of the store, if you've been in there, there is a facade up against the wall, small front of a building. Because I try to sell buildings as one of our products. And it's tough to sell a building from...
just the front wall.
Just the front wall. So now that the store's up and been there for 2 years, we had returned back to Jordan's and then asked them if we could do this, and they said fine. So these three buildings will be a modular, pre-built, carrying the walls, the floors, boom, boom, boom. I can take them down in 4 hours. Mm-hmm. It's just going to be a place to take the customer out and say, hey, this is the real deal, mm-hmm. you know, and then try to tell them.
Yeah.
And that's it, really.
Okay. The so the doors in and out of Jordan's are pre-existing?
Correct.
Okay. The patio area, I mean, that's up in the air. That's over the open storage area of the Home Depot, which is down below.
Correct.
I don't remember offhand what the border railing or...
Yeah, there's a galvanized steel railing system that runs around the outer perimeter there.
Okay.
I believe the height of it is approximately 4 feet, slightly lower. Glenn Redmond looked at that to verify that it met code for the safety of that railing.
And you mentioned in the write-up that it would be not freely available to the public. It would be an escorted visit, which is good.
Right. Our intention, I'm Steve Schultz, I work at Walpole in the Reading School.
Okay.
Our intention is to have a sign there where people come into our store and inquire about one of our sheds. After looking at the facade, they'd be invited to come down, you know, come out, take one of our representatives, and we'd bring them out there to walk them through if we had to.
Excuse me, I have a picture of that area where we put the sign. So people would be in the store and those three sheds through the glass, and there would be a sign there. Hey, come on back to Walpole, we'll take you out.
Yeah. Who maintains that patio? Snow removal?
Our crew and our subcontractor as well.
I mean, I know where that is in Jordan's.
So the excess inventory.
So this space, I thought I knew where this was, but this space is basically looking over
the highway.
The highway, right?
Exactly. Yep.
Yeah. Or so the Honda Gallery and so forth.
Directly underneath.
Well, over
the
on the other
sign, that trifold sign, directly underneath
the highway, right?
The highway side. Yeah.
So, could you see these? I don't have a
from Wakefield.
If you're a passenger, you might be able
to see the
to
top.
Look up.
Yeah, because it's a
right.
sort of a.
You can see the tops of the roof.
There's some trees though, so I mean, depending on what time of year.
Mm-hmm.
And so the path to get here is really around the, from where your store is in, within the building is, would be out in the back along the back by Fuddruckers.
Yep.
Yeah, actually, Gene, if you go back one slide, we have a floor plan layout there. I can forward one more. You were there. Yep, great. So you come in the front door of Jordan's here, and here's our themed entertainment area, Beantown. So basically, the Walpole store is right here. So people would come into the Walpole store, or if they're going through our store directly or coming from anywhere in our store, if they see this area out there where those doors are with the signs on them, it'll tell them to go see a Walpole representative, or the opposite would be they'll be in here and they'll walk out. This is Jordan's open, you know, floor space.
Yeah.
And it brings you right around to there to go.
Gotcha. Mm-hmm. My other thought on this, I think, is probably more administrative than not, but you know, on the site plan is listed three specific sizes and three specific types of sheds, which you know, my presumption is that's what you plan on having there now, but next year you might want something, you know, something sells better, you do a different product, and you may want to change one of these out to maybe a little different size or a little different, or a different type. And I guess my suggestion would be so that you're not continuing to come back to designate this area, not as this, these are the specific locations, but this is the location for three sheds.
Mm-hmm.
So that you're not, you know, you don't get stuck in that.
Yeah.
Like, oh, I want to change to a different style shed,
right,
and I could do it in 4 hours, but I need to come back to you guys.
We try not to.
Yeah.
We try to focus on the buildings that sell the most, and we put the accoutrements to them that people would want to look at, so we try to keep them so we don't keep spending our own money rebuilding that.
Usually
so
3 to 5 years.
At the minimum.
And then we'll sell them off, you know,
as demos.
And we'll put up some more.
Yeah.
No, we just, from an administrative point of view, if it's identified on the plan, then somebody, not us, but somebody might complain that you're changing without coming for the approval.
Yeah.
So if you just make the submitted plan more generic, you know, just put a for example next to the things.
I mean, is it possible? I look at Home Depot and they've got seasonal storage. Is that the right term? Sometimes they'll have planters and stuff like that outside. Sometimes they'll have stuff probably more for the summer.
Yeah, they've got a complicated open storage.
Yeah.
Permits.
Right, but the decision here doesn't say the size, it just says three sheds. So I would just change to say outdoor display of up to three sheds of varying size.
Yep.
And then they could have two with one larger one, or they could have three. Whatever they want.
Yeah, that's good.
Be okay with that?
Yeah.
Great. Needs more flexibility.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah, sure.
So in the findings, finding
number two.
Yeah, of up to three sheds.
While we're in there, I would change finding number three where it says that customers may be escorted by employees, because I think you're saying that they shall and they will be.
Will be.
And that's not anywhere near the cap, right? This is raised up and beyond the limits of the cap of the felt landfill.
It's actually the area over the Home Depot loading dock.
Oh, okay.
Where all the trucks go underneath.
Kind of unrelated to this specific thing, but are you guys, there's signs over there, correct? Overlooking the highway, you're not proposing changing any of those?
We changed the Sunbrella already.
Yeah.
But currently we don't have anything laid out to do that this year.
Okay.
More than likely, with the rebranding, the highway side, the big one up there.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking.
Which is very expensive maintenance-wise as well. In the future, we may be coming back to present that to you guys.
Okay.
But nothing as of right now.
No. That reminds me, no signs on the sheds then. Don't put any signs on the sheds. No big wall pole, LLC.
We were thinking, and I'll ask you, we were thinking of putting a sign, maybe the size of this table, one per on the left side of the door that just says the price, you know, what it is. So if that's the building, you know, we would put a sign on it just to say something about it. If that isn't okay, we won't, but, you know, we were just thinking it'd be, you know.
Well, it's
maybe the name of the shed and, you know, how much it is.
Colonial with the price.
Yeah, I think that's okay. Yeah.
Yeah, that's all. Nothing else but that. Small, too, nothing big. But no, we're not going to, like, put a sign up on the roof, and, you know, no way.
No. Buy sheds.
Yeah, right now.
Okay. Given that the customers are going to be escorted there and so forth, and, I'm not sure that you need the sign. I don't know how the other guys feel here.
Well, you can see the sheds from inside. Right on that plan right there, the bottom left corner, that's the column, that's the corner of the glass.
Right.
If I were standing there, I could see all three sheds and kind of get a sense whether, whether they were within or without my price range.
Right.
I think if their signs are small, no larger than that, say 2x3 and located at or near the door, they'll be low enough where you won't see them.
Okay. Yeah, not to exceed, what, 6 square feet, 4 square feet?
6.
Okay.
For where?
Each shed could have a sign up to 6 square feet located. At or near the door.
High level, you know, kind of.
High level, yeah. Describing the shed and its price.
Thank you.
So I'll just modify number 2, page number 2.
Yeah.
Okay. So lacking public comment.
Yeah. What do you hear?
Move that the CPDC close the public hearing for the open storage special permit for Walker Walpole Outdoors LLC at 50 Walker's Worth Drive.
Second. All those in favor?
Move that the CPDC approve the open storage special permit as amended for Walpole Outdoors at 50 Walker's Worth Drive.
Second. All those in favor?
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Thanks for your help,
Justin. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'll follow up.
Someone stop briefcase.
Oh, yeah. And glasses.
He's so excited.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Hi, how are you?
Good.
You here for Redding Woods?
No.
Which one?
Honest.
That's right. Looking at you, Mike. You look familiar. What are we?
You guys aren't doing anything controversial. There's nobody here.
No, not tonight. Come here back in January. Do we want to jump to Artis? So we can get our in and out?
It's not a... administrative approval, so it's not a public hearing. Might as well.
Yeah. Okay.
That'd be awesome.
Excellent. Gene, Jesse, anything you want to open this discussion up with? Or?
Did you have
the plans? Yep. So were they different than what you have previously
nope.
sent me? Okay.
Nope.
So we have
Do you want me to just click onto them?
The 772 is the one.
So other plans as well.
The overlay, no, it's the overlay plan, sorry. I thought you were doing it by the way I sent.
Yeah, I retitled them.
My name is Bill Bergeron from Hayes Engineering. I'm here representing Otis tonight. And what happened with the final design after the final approvals was that they actually had some small tweaking that they did to the building. And I had provided a plan. There's a red outline of the original plan, and then the other black outline is the actual footprint of the building that we want to do now. And the predominant change to the building was the addition of a patio area in the back here and the extension of the front open farmer's porch on either side of the front. The building actually is a little bit smaller than the original building that was originally approved. So there was a slightly smaller area here, but predominantly what happened is the original landscape plan was for around the perimeter, the front, and up to the front here. And I think at the time that they were going through the site plan review, they indicated to you that they were going to do something a little bit fancier in the back. They just hadn't figured out what they wanted to do back there. So what they did do is this new plan has these new sidewalks that are a lot more detailed than what was originally on the plan. This little area here is a putting green. This little area here has a raised planter in it that actually is for therapy for the people that are there. They plant and replant the plants, the plants over and over again. There is the outside seating and patio area that's in this location here. But what happened was because we ended up increasing the number of sidewalks here to compensate. I talked to George Zamboris about the increase in pervious area and also Chuck for Conservation Commission relative to how we could handle that. Originally, this little piece of the emergency access for a fire department was porous paving blocks. So what we did to compensate was we made the balance of that porous paving blocks. In addition to that, we made these five parking spaces on the right-hand side porous paving blocks. Our snow storage is right here, so we thought that was a good location to put those things there. Talked to George, and George sent an email that I forwarded to Gene and Jesse indicating he had no problem with that modification. That basically compensated for the increase in the impervious area. And I also got a correspondence from the fire department saying that they had no problem with that. It was the same material that we were going to use here. We're just going to use there instead. So those modifications are on this plan. In addition to that, what we did is we changed the style of the retaining wall here. The original plan that was approved was a VersaLock wall. I'm not sure if you understand what the VersaLock wall is, but predominantly that gets its strength by the tieback systems that go into the embankment. Mm-hmm. In this location here, we're fighting grade as we're going to the abutting property owners. So what we did is we changed that to a gravity block wall, which does not require the tieback into the embankment. So what it's going to do, it's going to let us save more of the trees as we head approach to the property line. We don't have to dig as far back from that. And that the wall is similar to the one we used when we did the Gilbert Insurance Agency up on South Main Street. I don't know if you're familiar with that.
Yep.
Across, yep. Just a little bit down from Sam's Bistro. So I had sent photos of what the wall would look like.
Yeah.
In that location. I also, knowing how George is with the grading from the top of the wall to the lot lines, I also made the wall just a little bit higher, up to 18 inches higher in a few locations to make the grading easier towards the lot line. So both of the changes were to try to save more of the existing trees and to make that slope a little bit more gentle and reduce the amount of excavation that we have on that portion of the site. And there was only one other minor change. The stormwater management area had a storm scepter system, and there were multiple pipes going into it, and the unit that was there specified had too many pipes actually going into it to make it effectively. So all I did is I put a drain manhole in front of it, collected all the pipes, and there's only one pipe going into and out of the treatment system. And that was the only change on that side of the site. In addition to this detailed landscaping plan, the lighting plan came in, and I don't know if you want to switch it to one. What they did, and it actually is shown on...
The photometric?
That one, the lighting plan. Oh, that's just the details, I'm sorry. It'll be that photometric. What they did is, these are just small lights. They're only 4 inches off the ground. They're adjacent to the sidewalk. And that's where all these little dots are on the sidewalk. And then there's some bollards that are up. These are 42 inches high, and those are like at the doors. They weren't originally on the plan, so we wanted to make sure that everybody was was happy with that. But those are just low-level lighting. It's just to make the sidewalks illuminated at night. So basically, those were the modifications that we thought that the CPDC might either administratively say that that we can have Gene and Jesse kind of approve that, or if you thought that warranted another hearing, or just wanted to get your input on where we thought we would go with this. As far as where we are, today they actually have let the contract for the wall construction. The wall construction is going to be, you know, a major element to get started with the project. They're getting bids now for the utilities and the site work. And they expect to start in the spring as soon as the weather permits. And then I think that they told Justine that it was going to be a 12 to 18 month build out for the start to finish on the project. So they do want to get, I heard what you said about the projects kind of hanging around. This one's been hanging around too long. But they've just spent a lot of time refining what they wanted to do with the building.
Yeah.
So I'd be happy to answer any questions or any specifics. I gave a memo, and then we gave a bunch of new plans relative to that.
So the photometric doesn't show any light spillage.
It doesn't.
But
well, it's got all on the 24 by 36. You can see what the light levels are in there. They're all lower than the required amount. Plus, we have that 7 foot high solid stockade fence with the 1 foot lattice work on top all the way around the whole site, in addition to that. And then we've got a, you know, huge elevation difference up to 10 feet in some of these locations for the retaining wall.
Right. That's actually what I was getting at. So, really, the front edge doesn't really matter so much. It's the back edge because the residential properties are up at the top of that hill.
Right.
And so even though the light isn't spilling onto their property because of the grade change, I'm wondering how much more luminous is the ground?
These are just, I don't know.
What kind of foot candles?
Mm-hmm. Well, they're the downlights, right?
They're downlights, and they're only 4 inches off the ground. It's just to illuminate the sidewalk, so it's...
Oh, they're only the four, they're not the bollards.
Right.
The bollards are only at the doorway where they go in and out.
Right.
There's two there, there's two here, there's two there, and I think there's two there, and there's two there.
Okay, that's fine.
The bulk of them are those.
I don't know why I kept thinking it was all bollards along
no,
the path.
No, they're that.
And David, to your point, even though they're pointing down, if I'm lighting a white surface, I'm lighting a white surface.
I know.
You know, it's all going to come back up. So there's a, sort of this luminous aspect to it. But okay, they're just the low ones.
So we had another project recently where they were proposing porous pavement for the whole parking lot, and George was not okay with that. But he's okay with it here, I assume, because it's limited?
It's limited. It's not where the main driveways are. You know, it's for the emergency access, and it's for off the parking in the front where we don't think anybody's going to park there anyway.
Is there maintenance required? He mentioned vacuuming it, I think, right? Will that be something that...
It's got to be, yes. Instead of a regular sweeper, you have to vac sweep those to make sure that they retain their porous.
Okay, and you guys will be prepared to
part of the,
do that.
We already had that in the plan because we had the blocks on the other side.
Yeah, that's right. Okay. Okay,
yep.
Great, thanks. Anything from your perspective? John?
Yeah, looks perfectly reasonable.
Any concerns with this?
I mean, as long as George has
approval?
I mean, George is the master of the stone walls. He's gone over this.
Oh, I don't know. Have you guys had any feedback from the neighbors? All the neighbors seem to be okay with the plan originally.
Yeah, I haven't received any complaints. There was a little back and forth at the time they were doing the driveway for the abutters to the north, just getting that finished, but.
Mm-hmm.
That's been completed. All of the off-site work for that abutter, the land transfers, and that's all taken care of. The driveway was redone, and a separate order of conditions was done for that, and that's all been completed.
Right.
Just general inquiries.
Mostly people saying, when are you going to get it done?
Right.
Yeah.
When can we put our...
Will this be finished before perfectos?
Yeah.
The fun raddies?
So the I did verify with the fire chief, and he is okay with this, but he would like a condition in the approval that they follow the requirements for the specs, the installation specs, and the maintenance of the pavers that they looked at. So I would include that, as well as any other requirements that George would need, but I think he's fine.
Okay, good. All right, let's go.
So, do we need a vote or determination, or?
It's sort of like the other one about if you want to have
okay.
staff.
Yeah.
Move that the CPDC determine that the minor modifications for the heir to senior living are subject to administrative approval.
Second.
All those in favor?
Excellent.
Okay.
Thank you very
Thank
much.
Thank you.
Thank you for
taking
the
time. All right. Are we good? Do we want a break? Keep going?
It's only 8:30.
Yeah, that's true. Let's keep
going.
Hey, Ray. How are you?
How are you?
Good. It's been a while. What's that?
You gonna take me now?
Yeah, I think, yeah, why not? Absolutely. Don't want to tie you up anymore.
Yeah.
So what are we...
In case we didn't get the news, it turns out we'll approve the zoning changes today.
Oh, good.
Oh, excellent.
Subject to only one caution. That is, in site plan review, when you do when you collect money for a peer review of the site plan, you have to, Section 23G is not applicable to site plan review. It's only special permits and variances that don't have to do it. So you don't have the ability to turn them. So, if you take a fee, make sure you spend it.
Interesting.
All right. Okay.
But hey, good news.
That's all I could come up with.
That shows. Yeah, that's right.
So that is good. And we also approved Section 7, Article 7, which was the transfer of the property into the PRD.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's right.
Jesse Wilson.
Yeah.
They had gotten they had gotten comments suggesting that proper procedure had not been followed in adopting that. I remember there was some question about they hadn't gone to the CONSCOM for a hearing.
Yeah.
And it's clear the Attorney General didn't quite know what to do with that comment, and so she punted. It's outside of her jurisdiction to rule on that. So,
it's outside of her jurisdiction to rule on whether proper procedure had been followed?
Yes.
How is
that? You do need to read this decision because it's a masterpiece.
Yeah.
Only certain procedures are within her purview, she says. And that this one is not.
Okay. You lawyers are crazy.
But you got the results you wanted.
Yeah, I understand that, but I don't like the inconsistency on
if
what they're responsible for. Find out.
I imagine that it's a case of if we created the procedure and they approved the creation of it, then they don't necessarily accept the enforcement of it.
She can rule whether we follow procedure or not.
She said that was a fact-based inquiry. And therefore, since they only look at things whether they're facially valid, that's the reason.
Okay. I'm going to hold her to that.
Okay.
Or him, whoever's going to rule.
Get it in writing.
Okay.
Okay, so.
So that's the good news. And the bad news is that we still have half the time that I want to
do. So, speaking of which, do we have a document which is up to date in terms of what has been approved and what is in effect?
Yes, I was going to bring you all a copy tonight, but since we got the approval, it doesn't have November's changes. I can still go grab them if you want them.
No, just
but
do one.
Yeah, we've been working on.
Well, we've been. I've had the copies since I think January, and we haven't met, so I haven't been able to give them to you. And now they're outdated because we got the approval today. So.
Well, the. Okay, I'm confused. So the. You've got the copy with the September changes.
Yes.
Correct.
Okay, and now we've got the November
yeah.
as well. Okay.
Yes.
Yeah.
Got it.
So, in your packets, I know we discussed this in January about sending out a memo to the other boards, committees, and commissions, which we did, and they had a lot of time to comment because we haven't met. And we did get some comments. I've included those in your packets. It starts on page 77. We received an email from Megan Young-Tapoya of the EDC, some folks concerned about the Aquifer Protection District and solar panels. And then Chuck Taroni had sent me an email, but.
What's he from?
He, on behalf of the Conservation Commission, they want to be tied in and into the process for the PRD. So, you know, when we have the PUD on the agenda for tonight, but when I do have that tentatively scheduled for next
23rd.
The 23rd. And so I've told Chuck that it may be beneficial to have somebody from the Conservation Commission come to that meeting. So, other than that, that's all I've received. So.
Yeah, I was a little underwhelmed with that response.
I'm not surprised. I mean, I think that, you know, we had a lot of information go forward in November, and, you know.
People are tired of it.
People are tired. And then even just trying to, you know, even as part of that big update, just getting people to. Just town meeting members, we really didn't have a lot of engagement until the last minute anyway, so it's so early that I think that could be one of the reasons. So I think we wanted council here. We obviously have identified, you know, some ideas on what we want to move forward with, the PUD, the PRD, and the Aquifer Protection District. You know, we did receive these other comments.
And that's for November town meeting?
For November, yeah. But if there was anything else that, you know, there was a lot of things we talked about, you know, cleaning up wise with council that maybe we should consider as well. So that's why we have council here.
All right. I have two main recommendations.
Yeah, please.
And that is, I don't think we should proceed with the sign bylaw at the present time. The reason is that the U.S. Supreme Court recently heard arguments in a sign case. A town of Gilbert, Arizona, appears to regulate signs by function. So direction signs have one set of rules, and accuracy signs have another set of rules. that has been challenged, all the way up to the court. And the question is, if you regulate by function, are you actually regulating the content of signs? And I wouldn't touch that issue with a 10-foot pole until I see what the U.S. Supreme Court says on it, because I don't know how to guess. The oral argument already took place. And the justices, according to the news accounts, were horrified at both sets of arguments. They didn't like what any side seemed to be saying. So not much to predict there as to how it's going to come out.
But they have accepted the case?
They did accept the case. I actually wondered whether they might decide to dismiss the certiorari as sometimes after argument they say, oh, we never should have taken this case. So they dismiss it as certiorari improvidently granted. And just get rid of it that way. I'm not predicting that, but I don't know how it's going to come out. Our sign bylaw has lots and lots of provisions that differentiate based on function of signs, and I'm going to take that on until I see what the next school says. I don't want to have to stop and rejigger it.
Yeah.
Chances are that decision will come out in June, and so in theory we could still get it done by November. But
it's a whole lot of time.
Yeah. You know, I'd rather delay that one. And that's probably the hardest thing on your menu anyway. So.
Yes.
Yeah.
So I would suggest that we table that till we
let,
see.
Let the sleeping sign lie. Right.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, you know, eventually we're gonna have to fix it.
Right.
We might as well have some instructions from the Supreme Court before we do.
Yeah.
Ray, can I ask you, would we also want to postpone any public process? Because we've talked a lot about trying to engage the business community a bit more.
In the signs?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think...
Don't even go there?
Don't even bother.
Okay.
Just don't even go there.
Yeah.
Until,
it would just be easier once you have a clear idea of what you can and cannot
yeah.
permit.
Yes, assuming that we're going to get a clear idea, of course. We sometimes... don't get the clearest decisions out of the Supreme Court, but we might as well wait and see what they have to say.
Well, it's probably some brownie points with the business community if we just alert them to the circumstance. We just say that, you know, this has happened, therefore we are going to defer any further action on the signs. Give them the heads up because they're not tied into the same things.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And the EDC. Okay. Well, that makes sense.
Mm-hmm. My other recommendation is that you move ahead with your cell tower bylaw.
Which?
Cell towers.
Okay.
And what's discussed on town meeting floor briefly, right?
Mm-hmm. Here's the thing, it doesn't look like your cell tower bylaw has been revisited in some time. What you have is a bylaw that assigns cell towers to particular parts of town. But the Federal Telecommunications Act requires that towns allow cell towers if a need can be demonstrated. So your bylaw doesn't make any provision for need to be demonstrated. In those circumstances, what typically happens is you apply your bylaw, and the applicant runs off to federal court, and then the location and permitting of the cell tower occurs at in federal court in the standard before you, that's not what we want to do. So to, most of the more current bylaws require a special permit for cell towers. They don't specify where they can go, but require instead, A, that there is a demonstration that there needs to be a tower, and B, that the location of the cell tower is the least obtrusive place it can be, minimizing impacts. And that, of course, requires the applicant to say, well, we could put it here, or we could put it here, or we could put it here, and this is the reason why we did it this way, what have you. Even if at the end of the day you get, your decision gets appealed to the federal court, you will have saved yourself a lot of litigation costs because all of your discovery would have occurred in the permitting process, and so you'll have all the information that you need to defend your decision. So that really needs to be changed. The other thing that needs to be changed is there's a recent amendment to the Telecommunications Act which prohibits you from requiring any kind of discretionary permit for modifications to antennas on the towers. If the new antenna occupies the same area as one that it's replacing. So the bylaw doesn't have anything like that, so it seems to require a modification of the special permit in those circumstances. A lot of the cell tower cases that are, applications that are coming forward now are type or modifications to existing antennas. And it appears that your bylaw would require a modification to a special permit, and the federal statute basically doesn't allow you to have that. So those two things suggest that maybe we should just scrap the whole thing and start over. And I would like to see that happen sooner rather than later. So the soonest it can happen is November. So I would recommend that be put in the front of your list.
Have we run across models to follow?
Oh, we've got plenty of models.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, currently it's not called a cell tower per se, it's just a commercial communication structure, which has the implicit standalone commercial communication structure, which is not the same as sticking an antenna on an existing smokestack, which we did over in whatever it's called.
One General Way,
yeah.
Yeah, I noticed that terminology, and when I first saw it, I had to ask Jim what he even referred to. So it's different.
So that would mean for November we would do PUD, PRD, aquifer, the telecommunications tower. Did we say we were not going to do parking?
I would say that's something, I think that the last discussion was a lot to take on.
Yeah.
And we had a lot of discussion needed to be had.
We felt like parking and signs maybe could go together.
Okay. And the inclusionary bylaw, further study needed? I know we spoke about this, I'm sorry, I've just...
We did get a draft bylaw from our consultant, so we have some language, but Gene has more experience with it than I do, but it's a very challenging bylaw to get passed, and the draft we had wasn't really in the shape I think they would want for Reading, so that would just be the, longer discussion.
Okay. Inclusionary housing has a lot of ups and downs, and I think we really want to get it right if we're going to do it.
It's another one of these words that doesn't make as much sense as it should. Inclusionary, yes. Extraterrestrials over here.
When I looked at this schedule, even with the things that are on the schedule right now, I thought we were going to be challenged to get in a more polished form than we had last time around. I think after looking at the plan, the PUD bylaw, there's a lot there that I think will be difficult for. I think we could work our way through it, but I think once we bring that out, I think that there's a lot to wrap your head around. Might be a challenge to get that in that time frame. If we're also, especially if we're also going to do these other few advice that we ought to.
Yeah, sure.
I'm not sure there's a pressing need on the PUD like there seems to be probably a pressing need on the others.
I was going to say, we're going to rank it. Yeah, go ahead. I'm sorry, George.
Did you also mention PRD?
Yeah, that's on the list.
PRD is on the list.
As well?
Yeah.
So okay,
that's a smaller monster, like a baby monster, because we wanted to do it. It was like a matter of a meeting or a week. We wanted to do it. We didn't do it. It's about 3 or 4 pages. But PUD is 45 pages.
I would agree. PRD seems a little bit easier to tackle.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. And aquifer, I realize it's controversial, but we weren't suggesting a lot of changes, right?
Yeah.
We're almost there. The draft is...
Especially with the input from the DEP here, DES.
DEP, yeah.
So DEP has a model bylaw of that protection bylaw. And the condition, we have a very strange Water Management Act permit in this town because your wells are still permitted, even though one of the conditions is that you don't exercise any rights under it. There's a requirement in your Water Management Act permit that you have an aquifer protection zoning bylaw that conforms to DEP's requirements. So mm-hmm. That said, it's pretty easy to do.
Did you see the comments back from DEP?
I don't think so, but that doesn't mean you didn't give them to me. It just means I didn't see them.
Okay. Our bylaw is based off their model bylaw.
Already.
Mm-hmm. But what we're proposing are some changes to that, and we got a little bit of pushback from them in our language tweaks to the lots and to districts.
Mm-hmm.
And there was one other,
but I think there's a difference there. It's based off their old model guidelines,
mm-hmm.
not their model bylaw.
Okay.
So, right, because this was done a while back and they've progressed it, that's what it sounded like. They progressed it. So they've made changes that Reading didn't necessarily change.
They didn't like the lots in two district being subject to the review by the town engineer. They felt like there should be something else.
They felt that the AG would likely not approve that.
Yeah.
Hmm? Well, if you remember, there, we had a provision about that in the part that we've already changed that was of the same form, that the use authorized in the less restricted portion
yes.
may be extended.
Yep.
And I didn't like that then either.
Yeah,
so,
we had a lot of discussion about this.
So I probably suggest that that get changed, but at the end of the day, subject to review by the town engineer. So you're not suggesting that the location of the boundary line be subject to review of the town engineer. You're just that may be what they probably were objecting if they were.
Yeah, they were
yes.
objecting to the boundary disputes
yep.
and the lots in two districts.
Yep, those are the two key areas.
It seemed, when I read this, it seemed to me that that if you had a dispute, I'm not sure it's, I guess it seemed odd that the town engineer would be the arbiter of the dispute on the boundary, and that's it. There's no other provision for anyone else to go to except for the town engineer, because you're not going to this board or the zoning board, where you have a recourse if you don't like
mm-hmm.
the way that the case comes out.
Okay.
That's when I read it. That's the whole, if you don't agree with his analysis of the science, then what do? You have no, you sue the town? I don't know.
I have a feeling that the word over the established line is a word that, if you look at it from the point of view of town GIS, which will be a tool of the engineer, this is like 1 meter tolerance, 3 feet tolerance. But if you have a plot plan, you go to a few inches of tolerance, which will be more accurate. And that may be the cutting edge, whether you're in or out. So the town engineer may not have the actual tool or level of detail to determine definitively whether something is, you know, on the right or the left side. And when you furnish it, because you pay the surveyor, I guess, to furnish it in, then you're giving him the tool. That's how I read that.
Well, I'm not anything but expert in this area, but my first reaction to the issue would be to exclude the Aquifer Protection District from the lots in two district flexibility. To say that the Aquifer Protection District must be enforced up to the boundary without regard to the, you know, less restrictive, more restrictive. Because that generally applies to the boundaries between the fundamental zoning districts like residential versus commercial, or whereas the Aquifer Protection District is like a floodplain. You know, you don't move the floodplain. Yeah.
So to be clear, the Aquifer Protection District is the same as what DEP calls the Zone 2. So that's the area that has been determined by the hydrogeological
right.
study to contribute to the public water supply well, which is why it's a little weird that we
right.
have this, because we're not using the wells for public water supply, but nevertheless. In most towns, it's there primarily to protect the public water supply.
Mm-hmm.
And so somebody's done a study and concluded that here it contributes and over there it doesn't contribute anymore. It's
right.
some boundary mm-hmm. determination. So as a matter of policy, you might not like that. It might not be such a great idea to say, well, clearly always the district that the property that's outside the district will be less restrictive because it won't be subject to this bylaw.
Right.
And it might not be such a great idea to allow that to to go 50 feet in.
Well, I mean, that's...
Yeah, I mean, yeah. You're basically saying, well, as long as you, your contamination of the public water supply is, happens here, it's fine. So that's enough, like a good fit. And in any case, I wasn't fond of this even in the other, in the general context. So all things considered, I think you're right. You should just not, two lots.
Well, it's, I mean, certainly for the APD, I mean, we'll just, we could do away with that provision.
Just one comment that we got, which was a very strongly worded comment during some of the public inquiry period. We did hear from people that were concerned that their property only had a small sliver that was in the aquifer protection district. So a single family homeowner that just had a slight amount of the property in the district. But that problem is solved by the new language that says this doesn't apply to a single family home.
That change changes the tenor of the entire discussion.
Right.
Because then this is really more about all of those noxious uses and potential spills. It's not about people's driveways and decks and additions.
Correct.
I mean, it changes things
dramatically.
Yep. Yeah.
And that one change. So.
Yep. It makes us consistent with whatever other towns are doing.
Yeah, it makes it
look at the boundary in detail. See what the topography is around it, because that little sliver could be the drainage for the entire property, right? It could be at the back end, and 200 feet by 200 feet of drainage is just going right to the sliver, and so it does impact it.
But that little sliver should be just that little place with on your property that does go into that, into the watershed, right? So your property may be, you know, may drain in two directions. And that one little sliver goes into that watershed, and the rest of your property goes into the other watershed.
Right. What I'm saying is, let's say that your house sits at the crown of this property, and the last 2 feet at the bottom of this slope is within that. That line really should be at the crown, because all of this is impacting that bottom slope. And what I'm asking is whether anyone's ever looked at where the boundary really is relative to topography.
Well, isn't that the way the boundary got established?
I don't know. I've never looked at it in that way.
Is it refreshed? Yeah.
Probably not if you recreate your property.
That's part of the problem.
Yeah.
At least in theory, we shouldn't have a significant amount of your property draining into the aquifer protection district. In theory, the boundary should be such that whatever
natural,
the rest of it should be draining in another direction.
Yeah, we can, for the sake of clarity, assume or presume or whatever that the boundary was drawn in a sensible fashion.
But that's what the whole boundary dispute thing is about. I mean, no one's going to go dispute a boundary and say, oh, more of my property is in the aquifer protection, but there may be something where.
And that's why, I mean, we need something for the boundary dispute.
Yes.
We need some provision, procedure, I mean, whatever.
Absolutely.
But we don't necessarily need the solid blue paragraph.
Right.
Which is, after you properly identified the boundary, you know, you don't cheat over it.
You're in it or you're not.
You're in it.
But I guess the net of it is that we want to get that one done by in November.
So this is what I'm seeing for November, right? The telecom tower, the PRD, and the aquifer.
PUD if we can.
And what was the first one that you, the telecom tower?
Southwood.
I said, the first one I said was the signs, and I said don't do it.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I was pushing PUD out to April 2016. And then after that, we've got signs, parking, and the inclusionary bylaw. And that would be November or, yeah, I mean, that's late 2016, even 2017.
There are a couple of other things that we put in the parking lot. New things.
Yeah. Although, no, you're right. I'm trying to remember. Do we have that list handy?
I think it was in a JC email about 2 months ago for the holidays. You have these 3, 4, 5 things.
You had like a preservation bylaw? Was that one of them?
Yeah, an article.
Right.
And not a standalone, right? It was in the general use.
Yep.
Under the use tables, general goals.
The other one that I forgot about is the purpose, which we didn't get approved. And I think Zach in the last meeting felt that it was something worth taking forward that could really simplify it.
Yeah, just basically replace it with the
Lexington.
Yeah.
You know, simplify, clarify, etc.
Right, right.
Can I ask 2 procedural questions?
Yeah.
Is the ZAC still form and is VHB done?
No, yes.
No,
I've told
yes.
VHB we no longer need their services.
And the ZAC had their last meeting in February.
It's all up to you.
We're it.
Yes.
Has VHB run dry on feed and so on feed? Are they close?
We're under. We've not used all of the contract amount.
Can we use them like on demand on specific things that we might need?
If we were to want to.
I'm not sure about that.
But you might as well add purpose to the November
like a shopping list,
because that's really easy.
Yeah, we can knock that one out pretty quickly.
They just Lexington. They like
yeah.
Lexington.
Yes.
Cut and paste.
So the big change I'm seeing for November is not taking on PUD unless people feel otherwise. I tend to agree with John. It's a big body of work. Mm.
We're going to have some site plans come through as well this year. And so,
yeah.
Well, it is a body of work. It's also, cross our fingers, lower priority because of the likelihood of it being exercised. Mm.
Was we going to say something?
Yeah, I mean, I can take a stand at that meeting.
Oh, PUD?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, what is it?
It's broken into residential, industrial, business, I guess. There are three subparts to it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, there's 3 pieces.
And remembering which properties generated the authorship of this, each of these seconds, basically creating this PUD. Well, I still remember, I can take a stab at this to present something that makes sense to you folks. Maybe it's not the actual language, but the mechanics of what we can do to condense it.
When I read through this, it seemed, which is true, that a lot of it was written specifically for something
a given project,
and
well, we've got Johnson Woods, we've got the landfill redevelopment, and they Then we've got a couple of other infill.
Calrissos.
Calrissos.
And so in each section, the level of detail, I mean, some of the ideas are good, but they seem too pointed to a specific case. So it seemed to me like a point of like trying to figure out, well, is that level of detail, is that needed? Should it be a little bit more wide open?
Right.
It seems like we're really, these are shoehorn, you know, sort of really, if someone were to try and use this for something other than what it was intended, would it even work? But you don't want to open it up so wide that it's, you know, it's approving 16-foot towers, which it says in here. I mean, you know, so I don't think that's a big discussion at the town meeting. If we're bringing some zoning bylaw that's allowing 16-story towers in town, I think there's a discussion that will ensue. Even though it's in there already, you know? I mean, maybe it wasn't 16, but it was something tall.
I just wanted to remind everybody that, you know, as part of the November updates, we did include the PUD in the table of uses. So when we're looking at this, we'll need to make sure that we cross-reference and make sure everything
right.
is the way we intended and consistent.
You want consistent? Okay. And to that end, at some point, you're going to have to do something with the definitions. You've got definitions at the beginning, and then you've got definitions in individual sections.
Right.
We made a recommendation that ultimately all of the definitions should be moved to the definition section. When you do that, you're going to have to worry about the fact that some of the terms that are in the definition section now appear in other sections as well with different definitions.
One good example is FAR.
Yes.
FAR is strictly defined right now. Mm-hmm.
So we've drafted it so that it's at least a lawyer can figure out which definition applies, but that's no way to run it. We should have a definition, presumably the one that we just adopted,
mm-hmm.
and use it everywhere. And all of those definitions should ultimately get moved. So you can do it at the end, or you can do it as a project for November, whatever you choose.
Well,
November feels crowded. Not crowded, it feels appropriate at this point. Telecom, PRD, aquifer, purpose.
Yep.
That's my opinion.
Well, you may find too that as you start using the new bylaw, that we might find definitions that need to be tweaked or added. So.
Actually using the bylaw to find out what we did wrong.
Did you happen to pull up that list of parking lot items?
I don't know if we have it.
I'm not sure. I can probably dig through my.
I have it written down somewhere. Yeah, I know we have it. I wasn't sure if.
Mm-hmm.
So how does that impact our agenda for tonight? Just looking at what else we have planned. Where does this discussion fall?
Well, I did have on here to begin review of the aquifer and PUD, which we still can do. If we want to table the PUD, that's fine.
Yeah.
Aquifer, we did just have a
right,
discussion.
We just did it.
You know, I know a lot of it is going to be Ray's review, so you know, we can sort of
If the CPDC wanted us to continue with the schedule that we've prepared, obviously with the adjustments, we can bring back the Aquifer Protection District. I think it was for next meeting is when we're going to look at it.
So it seems that...
Yeah, go ahead, Dave.
Well, the parts of the bylaw that were approved, I believe, referenced our an updated site plan review guidelines and regulations. Mm-hmm. So that's something that, that
yes,
should
that,
be.
That is something that you probably should tackle
list.
Tonight.
Yeah.
Yep.
Okay. So we'll do that.
And although I don't think the new language calls for a public hearing to adopt these regulations, the CPDC may want to consider it.
But maybe it's the selectmen's policies. One of the documents outside of zoning says if you're going to change regulations, you need to have a public hearing.
Well, that's a good idea.
Yep.
That doesn't mean we can't discuss it tonight.
Oh, no,
no,
discuss
no,
it
wasn't intended to be. It was just discussion tonight.
Yeah. So we can tackle site plan review tonight. Seems like it makes sense to table PUD. Do we need to take Aquifer any further tonight?
I think it'd be helpful maybe if Ray took a good look at it.
Yeah.
I don't think we don't have it back on CPDC's agenda until the 6th of April, so there's some time.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Only
if
you can indulge me a little bit, the time period, the end of April that gets close to town meeting here. Maybe the first couple of weeks in May where I have town meetings in other towns. Whatever your schedule looks like, it would help me out a lot if you don't rely on me to do too much heavy lifting during that period of time. Because you won't get my best work. You get my work in the middle of the night.
I'll
fall asleep on town meeting floor.
I think at least for the Aquifer Protection, they're meeting on April 6th, so it would
so
be sometime before
that's
that.
Fine.
Sometime in March, we would
right.
want you to,
okay.
this month, a couple weeks.
You can do that.
Okay.
Okay.
So we'll bring that back. Site plan review we can tackle.
And PRD?
PRD is on for next meeting.
We're going to keep that.
Yes.
Yep.
What else do we have? Can we look at purpose then?
Next meeting?
Yeah.
Should be able to.
That seems like a pretty...
Yeah, we can bring, I can bring Lexington's template and we can go from there.
Yeah, this can be more just the process of cranking through.
Yeah.
I mean, the language is like 10 words or something.
Yeah.
I mean,
it's not much.
Right.
Right. Okay.
So next meeting will be PRD and purpose. And
four,
then
six. Keep going.
I was going to say, and then at some point, I don't know how we want to handle the commercial communications. If it's something that we want to scratch and start new, and if that's
mm-hmm.
something you're going to provide us with language,
I can.
Maybe that would be good for April 6th as well.
Okay.
Is that like a highly technical document or just?
Well, it will have some long words in it.
I just see us getting into it and being like, what the heck is going on here? So,
no, it won't.
Just have
it won't. No, I have every confidence in you. No, it's not. It's not that bad.
It was I mean, I just remember being described at town meeting as, I recall it being, you know, this will be a complicated section of our bylaw. Maybe that was in the context of reviewing it at town meeting.
I think that was in the context of it sort of popped on my radar screen relatively late in the game.
Oh, I see.
I said, this is too complicated to try to take on
okay.
this late game.
Right.
And it makes sense.
I was just trying to churn through the sort of most pressing things in time for town meeting, if you recall, we were making adjustments right up to town meeting. We are trying to avoid doing that this time.
Yeah.
So at some point, I just cried uncle and said, you can't, this is too hard to do now.
Yep.
But it's not actually, as I said, we've already done some of the bylaws in three or four other towns, so, we'll dust one of those off and see how it seems to fit. But the basic structure of it will be that you require a demonstration lead, and you require that this is the least impact solution to filling that lead. And then the only other sort of issue that some towns give a preference to municipal sites, so the town gets the government. Yeah. I don't know if that's something that you want to consider doing, but some towns do that.
Yeah.
Thank you. Are there any provisions that we can put about noise or radiation
You cannot put anything about radiation. The federal law prevents towns from considering health impacts from these. Okay.
It's so ridiculous just on its face, but
who wrote that regulation?
So you can't do that. So. I don't know that there's any reason why you couldn't put something about noise in there. The federal law is all about preventing municipal permitting authorities from
they're like the modern railroad, right?
Yeah, exactly.
We do what we want to do when we want to do it where we want to do
exactly.
it.
So when you say noise, is there a definition for noise? What frequency? During the ultrasonic?
It will probably be on the decibel scale. And we're talking about transformer, right? Transformer noise, this kind of noise.
The concern from the people whose property will be next to these things will be the radiation, which we're not allowed to discuss, but I'm saying, so if I say 10 to the negative 9th decibels, that's noise. My dog won't like it. It would give me cancer anyways, potentially. Those are the discussions I'm talking about. Is there a definition for noise? Because if we say 30 decibels, is that something someone will accept? Is it 0.1 decibel? What is the definition of noise? Audible noise by humans? Something else? It sounds to me like we don't have any control.
We're
going to write a zoning bylaw or something.
Noise.
We have no control.
We have no noise provisions. As it says, or just a generalized prohibition against the noise.
Outdoor loudspeaker, outdoor.
So specific noise generating activity.
I think that's in the general bylaw.
No. Well, there's provision for, a general caution against noise pollution or. Well, I've forgotten exactly what the words are.
I don't think we talk about decibels in here anymore.
No.
That's what you were.
No, but it's one of these, objectionable noise, or
it's an exercise in the bogus. It really is. We're going to write a zoning bylaw for something we can't control at all. It only prevents us from getting sued.
Well,
this does. Really,
this is
what we were doing. If you remember at town meeting, I objected to you writing a definition about what something was not.
Mm-hmm.
We're writing definition about what something wasn't, which is ridiculous. And this seems to me like the same thing, really. It doesn't seem like we have any control over it. That some lawyer will force whoever the applicant's hand. That's fine. We have to go through the exercise, but I'm just saying, let's not pretend that we're getting control over this.
Well, some towns have been successful in preventing the location of undesirable facilities by disputing the so-called meeting. And they've had somewhat more success in going at it that way.
Okay.
But if there's a gap in service, and you live here, so you know where the gaps are, if there are any.
Is that quantifiable?
There is, yes. They will do a gap study, and if you really want to do it, there are peer reviewers who can be retained to dispute it. Ironically, sometimes the filings that they have made with the Federal Communications Commission can be used against them because they have already filed with the feds that, oh yes, we already have coverage here, because they have milestones they have to meet and gain
right.
coverage. And so they may be claiming Reading already as having 100% coverage. That's really where the battle is whether there's a need. I'm trying to apply standards to them beyond that is quite difficult, because first thing is the most thing that you might be concerned about is the radiation and the federal law won't let you address that.
Well, but the thing that we might want to investigate at least a little bit would be electrical interference with adjacent
mm-hmm.
equipment,
mm-hmm.
Non-communications equipment somewhere nearby.
Where does it say you can argue that?
There are federal guidelines on,
yeah.
Something somewhere. I mean, we can probably find a regulation, an FCC thing that says that, you can't kill George's TV in the adjacent property, or, there just is. I'll bet there is.
It sounds to me like this: the federal regulations for this are overriding.
Well, he's not talking about
radiation
and health. He's talking about electrical interference.
Right. And the same kind of thing that there's probably some noise. We've got the general provision now that says no use shall be permitted which is offensive because of obnoxious noise, vibration, smoke, gas, fumes, etc.
That's ours.
That's ours, right.
That's overridden by the federal
yeah.
regulation that tells us they want a cell tower.
But there are, there's a bunch
not
of things.
Not
like
one.
Yeah,
there's
other
some things
that
can be done.
Yeah.
But it might be helpful, having rewritten the cell tower bylaw in one of our towns 3 times, to go from the most restrictive bylaw I've ever seen to one that's more accommodating, to now we have one that is essentially begging for someone to please come to town and put a cell tower so that we can enter the 21st century. You might want to think about how desirable or undesirable these facilities are. And so towns that don't have good cell phone service have a very different view from towns that have essentially good cell phone service, and they just really don't want to see any more towers. So.
Well, the thing is, of course, we want good cell phone service.
You just don't want the tower.
But we don't want the tower with 42 antennas on it, which
uh-huh.
is next to Udude Electronics and Needham. We wouldn't mind the fake tree, which is on 93.
Oh, I hate that.
Oh,
yeah. 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 Just to that.
If it's a tower, make it look like a tower.
It's a tower.
Oh, it's great.
I don't object to the look of the tower.
Of
what I want is the town to be able to control
Hampshire.
Where it can go, so it's not, smack dab in the middle of a residential neighborhood
mm-hmm.
where those people don't want it because their property values will get shot.
But
aside from that,
our terrain doesn't have. Such high peaks that, I guess the high school is...
Yes, you put it on the water tower up there.
The water tower, yeah. Okay, but that's not as close to municipal property, I guess, and we can...
Well, that is municipal property.
Oh, We don't have any other skills, not, you know, to call anyone, choose to go and install something because it's a, you know, it's a pronounced high point and they can get their bang for their buck. Access is not like a Newton.
Well, except Bear Hill and the Storm Border and the two lobes of the 28 Cloverleaf where they wanted to put the standpipes.
See, it's not necessarily for that program. That's the thing, right? If you think about the edges, right. They could be trying to attract, they could be trying to hit a zone that's beyond Reading, but the towers have to be in Reading.
Can we put anything about this peer review that you're saying that it could be an audited peer review that doesn't come like from their, you know, from the Baltimore office or their like private John Doe that did this need demonstration of need, that it is something that, you know, if it's, you know, if someone comes here and stands up and demonstrates the needs and it is the public, that there's some like apparent credibility into where this is coming from.
You want credibility? Or sure, we can put that in there.
Or maybe this from third party or that there's like a peer review that the town can.
Yeah, oh, absolutely. You will want to put in a provision for a peer review from the town. There are basically two guys that I know about that do it. And they sort of made a cottage industry of going around and disputing the need for
it. We'll just hire the competitors engineer.
No, because they all want to locate on the same tower.
Right.
So they want it. For example, they usually come in and comment on these things when they give them an opportunity. That you should be favoring co-location. Okay.
Right.
So that you, all the antennas go on a single tower. The result is you get fewer towers. That's a good thing. But you also have a taller tower because it's got to be tall enough to accommodate all the. All of it. So.
The other thing that we want to make sure we say at least something about is the. I don't know, the ground equipment that goes with the antennas.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we ran into the issue over at General Way, where the actual the radio equipment, if you will, was on the roof of the building. With the antennas up on the smokestack,
mm-hmm.
And we had to talk about the shielding and so on and so forth and the structural considerations for the transmitter. So we can't forget that it's not just the tower, it's the all of the equipment associated with the facility.
So you're going to provide us with
a model
that
we can chew on it give some. I'll try to make sure that as many of those points appear in the model. And that would be a good place to start.
And we'll have that for April 6th.
Yep, we still
yes, you will have it for April 6th. I wrote that down right for April 6th.
So March 23rd, we got the purpose and the PRD. April 6th, we've got aquifer and the tower.
Yeah.
And then the 13th.
I'll bring PUD also. I'm bringing craft of PUD.
Okay.
We can get started on that. the 6th.
With the goal of getting it included in November?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I
thought
we said
we were. Let's see how that goes.
Okay.
How easy it is to go through a trimming and compaction process.
Right.
You know, how clear it is to look at the parts and bring in to consolidate or to relate to other parts of the bylaw. And then we can make that call at that time, on the 6th.
Yeah. Good. It's in the not yet impossible for November category.
Yeah, that's fine. I'm just looking at the 13th. So
that's an added meeting.
That's an added meeting. It's not a meeting from later in the month that's moved up because of April town meeting?
Right. So we wanted to see if the board would be amenable to adding a meeting to accommodate a public engagement. We can stick with what CPDC has scheduled, but shift all of this down. The idea was that we really got through the public hearings.
as early as possible.
We wanted to really try and get it all done before June 30th, the public hearings.
Mm. Yeah.
And then July would be basically, if we're not finished and we have to keep going.
And then 6/29 is also an added meeting. Sorry, the color the black and white doesn't show up highlighted.
So right now there's only one meeting in April.
Right, and because we have town meeting.
Right.
Yep.
So we added, it would be a back-to-back, so we have the 6th and then the 13th for like a public forum.
A public forum is not a public hearing.
Right, I think this is to get input, you know, similarly to how the Zach.
Right.
Yeah. And you said that's school vacation week, do you think?
No.
It's not?
School
vacation is the 20th.
17th.
Well, yeah, it starts Friday the 17th, or Thursday the 16th, actually.
Okay.
Being the way you count it.
So
that's not Marathon Monday. Okay. Mm-hmm.
No. The 20th. Okay.
Can you maybe just send an email? I don't know. I don't know if I'm available tonight. I probably am, but can you maybe just send an email out?
Mm-hmm.
I am busy though. I'll be celebrating.
Well, we don't
so it'll be the added meeting of the, based on the schedule that I have, the April 13th and then June 29th.
April 13th is the public forum.
Public forum.
And June 20th is?
June 29th would be a night that we have a public hearing. We're going to do two nights of public hearings. So we're not doing. I can give you this, right?
Okay, that's
fine.
Page 82, right?
Yeah.
The March 23rd and the April 6th meetings, do you want me to be here for those?
So for the 26th, we're going to be having aquifer protection and commercial communication structures.
For the 6th?
For the 6th.
6th, yeah.
Yes. So yes.
I'd say yes to that.
23rd. Well, I'm mostly concerned about the March 23rd because that's when the historic district commission is meeting.
No, I wouldn't say we would need you for that.
We don't need
okay.
You.
The 6th would be good.
I already have to do that one.
That's for the
summer, I don't know.
What is that, summer? Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
For the 6th.
You can be there.
So, you know.
Yeah, no, I think the 23rd we're fine. The 6th, it may make sense to have you.
Communications and the PUD.
Right.
And
the PRD.
PRD.
Whatever it is.
Yeah.
Things on the list.
The PRD is March 23rd, yes.
PRD is March 23rd.
Yeah. And the aquifer?
April 6th is aquifer and telecom.
And
the
possibly.
Tower.
Okay.
And George is going to have a copy of the PUD.
Okay.
Gene, Jesse, you okay with that?
Oh, I'm sending an updated schedule out to everybody.
Yeah, that's great.
So you want me for April 6th, not for March?
Correct.
Okay, I can do it.
And I did find the list of the parking lot items, so that's up on the screen if anyone wants to take a peek at that.
So parking, we said we're going to take on later with signs.
Yep.
Preservation bylaw.
That's not for now.
Not for now?
This is
okay.
Not for this November, no.
The flow chart for permitting is being done with
MAPC.
MAPC. What does that say? Sustainable practices
for development, electric charging stations, pervious pavement, except for green roofs.
Where did this come from? What are we discussing?
This is the parking lot of items that we...
Right, but these sustainable practices. Well, wasn't it a comment during one of our open houses at the senior center?
I think so.
Came from the park?
Yeah.
About non-conforming uses, is there a way to allow things? Wasn't that kind of one thing? If they...
Mm.
Decide to do sustainable development, maybe the non-conformance is different, something like this.
Yeah, I
that would be difficult, too.
That's tricky.
Yes.
Yeah, really tricky.
That's interesting.
Perfect example is the e-cars place, right? If we conceded something to them, it disappeared.
Mm.
Right? Right. Cars comes in, let us build twice as big, put a green roof on. They disappear, and now it's some other use that's twice as big.
Okay. We want to take a quick break.
Are we good as far as saying that we kind of have our strategy for zoning, just so we can say to Ray, thank you for joining us.
Yeah, this was helpful, thank you. Okay. I think we've got a good plan forward.
Yeah.
I think we do have a good plan forward.
I'll email you the schedule.
I got it now.
Well,
you're
changing it.
Yeah. Okay. Okay, 5 minute
right,
break.
Thank you.
Good.
Yeah.
Thank you, Ray.
Thanks.
Thanks, Ray.
You're very welcome.
We'll come back and do a site plan.
Every day.